contact us to avail the combo offer of General Studies and Public Administration optional with 20% discount.
Good morning everyone. Today we are going to have the Hindu analysis of 8th July 2021. Let us see which are the important articles from today's The Hindu newspaper. Yes, good morning. So, yes, these are the important articles. Let us take overview of these articles first, then we'll discuss them one by one. Largely, they relate to mains examination, today's articles. Let us discuss them first. Darkness at noon failed by the judiciary. So, yesterday I told you that whenever the relevant article appears regarding the death of activist Father Stan, so yes, surely this article relates to our GS2 paper polity part, how judiciary has been, let's say, to some extent insensitive towards granting bail to these activists which are facing medical problems also, and we can say above the age of 60 and 70s. So yes, we'll discuss that along with some judgments of Supreme Court, how this judgment particularly regarding the cases which are filed under UPA Act, okay, Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. So we'll discuss that from polity perspective, GS2 paper. Then next, on page number 7, op-ed page, challenging negative social norms. So this context of this particular article, it is talking that India has reached to the sweet spot where it can harness the demographic dividend, the huge potential demographic dividend that India has. However, the article also provides there are some challenges, concerns still remaining in harnessing that demographic dividend, and way forward is mentioned. This is important from society perspective. So demography or population, that part very important, society GS1, then social justice also GS2 paper, and essay topic, we can expect such essay topic simply on the basis of demographic dividend. Next, perfecting the test, on page number 6, editorial. This particular article having context of recent announcement of new assessment scheme by CBSE. Okay, so how this particular scheme is good, the positives, along with that some of the limitations and the way forward, all this we have to take input from GS2 paper, governance part, human resource development, HRD. Okay, next, a long road for migrant workers. In this particular article on page number 7, op-ed page, the article, in one article itself, it provides for how Supreme Court has taken various measures in last 1 year towards social security, along with that the welfare of migrant workers. Okay, so which decisions were taken, the directives to the central and state governments, in one place itself they are mentioned. So this is we can use them, we can write them down, make note and use them in essay paper, as well as social justice part, okay, GS2 paper. And lastly, the new changes which are brought in the cabinet of the central government, not directly relevant to our examination, but just to be aware about all these developments. From miscellaneous perspective, you should be aware about these developments. And lastly, practice prelims MCQs, important captions and quotations. We found some important captions, quotations, they can be directly used in essay paper and other mains examination papers. So we'll talk about them also. Now let us go into detail. First article, darkness at noon failed by the judiciary. So yes, recently the death of activist Father Stan Swamy happened. Actually, he was charged under UPA Act regarding the Bhima Koregaon violence few years back by NIA, National Investigation Agency. So what are the issues involved here? It is being called as institutional death. Okay, why institutional death? Yes. Okay, everyone facing same problem? Yes. Okay, just a moment. Yes, am I audible clearly now? Yes, yes. So let us continue now. We are talking about the death of activist Father Stan Swamy. It is being called as institutional death. Why being called as institutional death? Because certain issues are involved. We have to understand what are these issues. First of all, the writer is saying that it is systematic abuse of majority and authority. Will not use such kind of statement in your answer, but surely we will say that disregard for rule of law. Disregard for rule of law, we can say that. Why? Because we are going to understand why it is disregard for rule of law as well as lack of sensitivity on the part of judiciary. Okay, so these two important aspects we have to understand, and to some extent we can change the naming of this argument here or the wordings of this argument. We can say that the excessive or arbitrary use of power or authority. This is the right statement. What we will write down here? The excessive or misuse, abuse of power or authority. Surely our law enforcement agencies sometimes, whenever let's say some extreme laws or legal provisions are invoked, like for example UPA Act or NIA Act, basically these are related to terrorist activities or extremism, to deal with extremism in the country, and therefore these provisions are having some kind of impact on those who have been accused under these provisions. Okay, so we can use such words and then disregard for rule of law. Now we have to understand what happened on behalf of judiciary, but before that let me give you idea what happened is, in that particular Bhima Koregaon violence case, there was let's say in 2018 raid of his house and by Pune police, Maharashtra police we can say, and then whatever the smartphone, laptops, everything from his home was taken away, and from let's say whatever the documents in that computer or smartphone, those evidences were used by the NIA later in 2020 to arrest Stan Swamy, and the provisions of UPA Act, Unlawful Activities Provision Act. Okay, so Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. Under this, many such sections of this act were invoked here. Okay, now we have to understand this is very stringent law, and therefore here the lack of sensitivity on the part of judges, this has been the problem here. Why? Because many a times on behalf of the person, medical bail was sought in judiciary. However, this was continuously denied, even though the medical examination of the person had said that the person is facing the Parkinson's disease. He was not able to do the basic course, daily life course, and therefore because of that he needed the bail on the basis of medical conditions, but that was denied, and normal bail was also denied. Okay, so this shows some kind of insensitivity or lack of sensitivity on the part of judges. Now we have to understand the idea of presumption of innocence is on weak footing in the country, especially invoking UPA Act. Recently we have seen in last 1 year many such people. For example, recently Delhi High Court gave the bail to 3 student activists in CAA protest case or Delhi riots case that happened in 2020. Okay, so again the provisions of UPA Act were invoked against them, and we have to understand that getting bail under this is very difficult. However, we have to understand that the basic premise, presumption of innocence, this is the basic premise for criminal justice और वी कैन से क्रिमिनल लॉ एंड प्रोसीजर. दैट मीन्स इनोसेंट अंटिल प्रूवन गिल्टी. Innocent until proven guilty. This is the basic premise for criminal justice, criminal law. However, here in UPA Act, the stringent provisions actually says that the bail is not to be given unless and until the sufficient, let's say, proof is available made by the person who is accused to overturn the charges. Okay, now that means the ball is in the court of that person who is getting accused here. Okay, so this is actually the problem. So in this part, it is very difficult to prove that the charges are not true. Along with that, we have to also understand in this particular case in 2019, the Supreme Court has itself set the wrong precedent. What Supreme Court has said in this NIA versus Zahoor Ahmed Shah Watali case. Okay, it is famously known as Watali case. Okay, so in this Watali case, the Supreme Court has said that first thing, whatever the charges are there, they are considered to be true. Okay, charges in FIR, first information report, they are considered to be true by the judges. Now this goes against this principle, presumption of innocence. If you are considering those charges as true and asking that person to prove these charges are wrong, this goes against this principle, natural justice principle, we can say. The second aspect is regarding bail. So, bail is not to be given unless and until that person has sufficient proof to prove that these charges are incorrect or false. Otherwise, that person is not to be given bail. Along with that, it has also said that unless and until the trial is started, the person should not be given bail or that person should be remain in the jail. This is how the Supreme Court has set the wrong precedent in this particular case. And therefore, now the high courts also follow this precedent and they do not provide bail to such persons who are charged under UPA provision. Okay, so you should be aware about all these issues, and that's why it is being called as institutional death. Now, you should be also aware that many other such activists in that Bhima Koregaon case, they are still facing the jail term, they are still under trial, and they are also above 60 years of age, facing many such medical complications. And therefore, again in future, the government may come under the scrutiny when any kind of such incident happens in future. We have to also understand our CJI, Chief Justice of India, from time to time says that the judiciary should uphold the civic liberties of the people. On the other hand, judiciary itself is working against it. This is against the civic liberties, the freedom, or we can say that the basic human right, that is right to life, is denied. Basic human right or right to life under Article 21 of Indian Constitution is denied here. Right, so yes, all these issues you should be aware here. Okay, so let us not go into, let's say, getting emotional or about whatever the matter you may be reading on the social media websites. Rather, you should be very objective in the evaluation of this particular issue. Fine, any question regarding this? Okay. Now, moving on to next article, challenging negative social norms. Okay. So, yes, tell me.
Well, is there any deliberately any political influence on that institutional comment on that day?
Okay, we will not say that any kind of deliberate institutional, or we can say the government influence on the judicial cases, something like that. Okay. The government successfully argued in the court that the person should not be given bail. That is the case. Okay. That is the case. Government successfully argued that the person is threat to the society, or we can say may lead to the violence and all these arguments provided by the government, and Supreme Court or the judge accepted that, and the person who was accused was not able to prove that false, those charges false. Okay, fine. Yes, yes. Sorry? Yes, yes. Right to life? Yes. The government will not actually implement any fundamental right unless and until the court is protecting those fundamental rights. Right? Supreme Court is the ultimate protector, guarantor of fundamental rights. Okay. So basically, it is the duty, responsibility of the Supreme Court or judiciary to protect the fundamental rights of the people. Okay. So, because actually some of these fundamental rights are restrictions on the powers of the government, authority of the government. Okay. And surely any government will not want to restrict its authority or power. Right. We know that power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely. Right. So, all these statements written philosophically for this reason only. Okay? Fine? Okay, so next article, challenging negative social norms. Here we are focusing on gains and challenges in harnessing demographic divide. One of the very good fact that is written here in the first part of the article, it is saying that India's half of the population is now under 29 years of age group. This shows that half of the population is young in a productive age group, and therefore we have huge demographic dividend for next two to three decades, we can say, the potential of demographic dividend, and that should be harnessed for economic and social development of the country. That should be harnessed for economic and social growth and development of the country. Now, how we have achieved so far, how much we have achieved so far? Yes, some positives. First thing we can say that the total fertility rate at present it is 2.2 and reaching to replacement rate of 2.1. So, many states have already achieved replacement rate. Some of the, let's say, northern and eastern states, they are also progressing towards reaching the replacement rate. Surely, this is the indicator that the population rate, population growth rate is declining, and because of that, the population is stabilizing. We can say population growth is stabilizing in the country. The second aspect is that we have to understand the government through various schemes, for example, Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, is focusing on, let's say, dealing with social issues, social norms, regressive social norms in the society. Okay, and therefore, the women empowerment, focusing on the women's education, balancing the child sex ratio, all these are actually against, we can say, or we can say the social issues like patriarchal society, patriarchy, or lower position of women in the society. These social issues are being dealt by the government through various schemes. So, this is having some positive outcome now. Okay. Now, what are the challenges after this? The challenges still persist. For example, first thing we have to understand that the reproductive health of women, this is still the problem, because women are not having the autonomy and we can say knowledge, empowerment and autonomy to have the right kind of reproductive health. And this is becoming problematic. For example, if we are talking about some facts here, still there is large number of cases, child marriage, which also results into early pregnancies, pregnancies in adolescence, around 20% at present. So those girls between the age of 15 to 19, adolescent age, so around 20% of the pregnancies still exist in that age group. So this shows to some extent that reproductive health, let's say services and the empowerment of the women, awareness about what kind of, let's say, contraceptives are to be used, family planning, all these are not provided to the women. And therefore, this is again the problem or the challenge. The second important aspect here you can talk about is regarding the women empowerment, especially in terms of economic terms, economic empowerment. So women employment, if you are talking about, still there is a very big gender gap in terms of employment, and due to pandemic again the women have not came back to the work outside the home as compared to men. This means that women are losing on the employment. This is again the major problem. And the third aspect we have to, here you can give the example of global gender gap report. Global gender gap report in terms of, let's say, employment and payment. So 2021, this is given by World Economic Forum. So India's ranking has fallen by 14, let's say, in ranks. Now India ranks 140th out of 157 countries. This shows a very sorry state, poor condition in terms of women empowerment. You need to provide such data or, let's say, reports, references in your arguments. Okay, so as a way forward, what we can write here, whenever we have to harness the demographic dividend, you can draw like this, demographic dividend. Harnessing this demographic dividend, that means we need to focus on health, we need to focus on education, and we need to focus on skill development. Then only the demographic dividend can be harnessed. Yes, many students may not be knowing about this term. Demographic dividend means when the population of any country passes through a particular situation wherein the working age population is larger than the dependent population like children and aged people. That provides the demographic dividend for economic growth and development of that country. Like for example, at present in India, the working age population, young population is more, and this provides opportunity because in future, significant part of this population is going to be dependent population, and then we will not be able to have appropriate economic development. Okay, so that's why to harness this demographic dividend, we need to focus on health. That means whatever the working age population we have, that should be healthy population. Then their productivity will increase and then they can contribute more to the economic development. Then the education levels, surely not only the schooling education but higher education levels. At present the focus of the government is only on the school education. But the higher education, we are seeing that the kind of situation in terms of quality of education is very poor, and though the people are getting degrees, especially in the engineering and those technical degrees, but the applied aspect, the people are not getting jobs even after getting degrees because they do not have right kind of skills, or the skills are not imparted in these educational institutions. right kind of skills. And therefore, the government should focus on the skill development of the young population. So, appropriate kind or right kind of skills, those are which are in line with the Industrial Revolution 4, that is the new kind of technological developments that are happening, artificial intelligence, data analysis, IoT, Internet of Things, or blockchain technology. All these are the new technological developments. In future, the jobs will be created in that field, and therefore the skill development should happen in that field. Okay, so in this manner you can talk about this, and whatever the policy development that government is having in future, this policy should revolve around youth and especially women. Youth and women. Okay, so then only in future we are able to harness this demographic dividend. What kind of question? India has entered into a sweet spot of its demography. Discuss the potential that India has in terms of its demographic dividend and the challenges in harnessing the same. Simply just now we discussed the potential as well as the challenges. Fine? Okay. Any question regarding this? Yes.
So why it is set as a
sweet spot? Sweet spot, that means any country passes through this, let's say, demographic transition. There is one theory, demographic transition theory, and in that every country passes through this sweet spot. Why sweet spot? Because it provides the opportunity. It provides the opportunity for economic growth and development of the country. Because working age population is having the high kind of, let's say, energy as compared to the dependent population. For the dependent population, the more government expenditure has to be done for, let's say, child care or the elderly care. But working age population does not require care of the government, rather it contributes to the economy, contributes to the society, right? And that's why at present about 50% of the Indian population is below 29 years of age. That means we are going to have this working age population more in next 2 to 3 decades, and after that the dependent population will increase, that is the aged population, because this population is going to get in the higher brackets in the population pyramid. Okay? Yes. So, moving on to next article, perfecting the test. Basically, it is having the context. Yesterday we talked about the announcement of this new assessment scheme for class 10 and 12 for this year. This is announced by CBSE. So, the context is that what is this new scheme of assessment? We have to also know about this. Yes, the internal assessments. Plus, we can say two terms and examinations, or two terms and followed by exams, plus reduction in syllabus and rationalization of syllabus. Plus emergency provisions. Emergency provisions. In this two terms, one term will be term one examination will be MCQ type, term two examination will be theory, or let's say short and long answer types. Okay, written examination in terms of theory, we will say written examination. Yes, MCQ multiple choice questions in first term. Now, what are these emergency provisions? Suppose the term 2 examination is not able to be conducted, written examination, then again this can be shifted to MCQ type of questions. And suppose the situation is that we are not able to conduct all these examination, then internal assessments and the assignments, whatever the evaluation is done, on the basis of that the marks can be given. Okay, so yes. Internal assessment.
Yes, sir.
Yes. The focus is largely on internal assessment here. Okay. Basically, these term examinations, whenever they are not, we are not able to conduct these term examinations, the internal assessment will be used for marking purpose or evaluation purpose. Okay. So yes, this means that the students, the parents, they have clarity in advance now. They have the clarity in advance. Okay, here positives, you can say that the emergency provisions are there. There is rationalization of syllabus, because surely the syllabus is huge that needed to be reduced, because many students are not able to attend the classes. Many schools are located in a remote locations. They do not have access to the internet or these digital infrastructures. And therefore, by understanding this, the overall syllabus is rationalized, it is reduced, and it is divided into terms appropriately. Okay, so these are the positives we can say, and the concerns of those students who are not able to regularly attend the online classes also, yes, they are also considered here. Now, what are the limitations? What are the limitations after this? The limitations, first thing we have to understand, the digital divide. In the country, yes, surely digital divide, first thing, in terms of digital infrastructure, many students still are not able to attend these online classes due to lack of digital infrastructure like smartphones, computers, laptops, tablets. Along with that, digital divide in terms of internet connectivity. Okay, so internet penetration, especially in rural areas, remote locations, it is not still there, and therefore they are not able to have or attend these lectures. Digital divide in terms of schools also, like those located in the remote locations, these schools are not able to provide the lectures on the online platforms. Okay, so this is the still limitation we can say. The second aspect we have to understand the in terms of limitation is the objectivity in evaluation. Okay, so we do not know, because internal assessment, that will be on the basis of school level, right? And when we are leaving that at each school level, they will have different kind of, let's say, objectives, or we can say criterias on the basis of which the evaluation is to be done. Okay, so therefore it is to some extent it will be a subjective matter. Okay, so this is actually going to be the problem in future. And third thing we have to understand that to address this, or we can say instead of this, we can write down the way forward now. In terms of way forward, first thing we can say that there should be some flexibility given. There should be some flexibility that should be given to the schools, especially which are remotely located, or we can say students with special care is needed. For them, the evaluation should be completely different. Evaluation criteria should be completely different, and the local level, the local boards or regional boards of they should be allowed to set the criteria for assessment purpose. There should not be directly centralized assessment criteria directly, we can say, imposed at local level or all India level basis, because CBSE is the central board, and therefore if you are having such kind of, let's say, imposition of any assessment criteria, then we need to also understand the problems faced by those schools or students who are not able to access the lectures also, or digital study material also. Okay, so the flexibility is also required at local level to some extent. Okay, so as a way forward, you can also mention about this. Fine. Surely the other aspects are already there, bridging the digital divide and ensuring the internet connections and the digital infrastructure to the students, to the schools. That is, again, you can write down all those points here. Fine? Yes. Any question?
Sir?
Yes?
Sir, why don't the past government and the present government are not able to implement the military rules to develop in the education system? And in terms of infrastructure, only infrastructure development,
then why don't they not apply the military principle? Okay, so infrastructure, why they are not able to? See, from time to time, various committees, commissions, they have said that there is increase in public expenditure in the education sector, but it has not increased above 3%. At present, it is about 3%. Okay. So, National Education Policy also, National Education Policy 2020, it also says that it should reach to 6% of GDP. So, public expenditure, that is government expenditure in education sector should reach 6% of GDP. Then only we can understand the appropriate infrastructure creation can be done. So, at present, the government is not focusing on the infrastructure because there is to some extent automatically the privatization of the education. Okay, the focus, we can understand that there is liberal aspect is given and the people are given choices, and when we understand that the quality of education in the government school is not up to the mark, the people are opting that their wards should go to the private schools. Okay, this is the situation. This is facing in the tier 2, tier 3 cities also now. And therefore, there are very less incentives to invest in the education sector by the government. Okay, but still, we have to understand that the significant proportion of the population is not in the schools itself. So, access to education, this is the responsibility of the government and even the fundamental right of every child between 6 to 14 years of age. And therefore, they should be getting this education. This remains the responsibility of the government. And therefore, the government should provide the educational facilities. Okay. So, yes, in this manner you can talk about, but facts, at present 3%, it should grow to 6%. A long road for migrant workers, we are talking about from the social justice perspective, or even in essay paper, we can expect such question or essay topic. We are talking here that how Supreme Court has come to the aid of migrant workers and protect them. For example, in last 1 year, many such directives given by the Supreme Court for ensuring food security, travel to the home by the state governments, for example, in its order pronounced in 2021 May, it laid down that dry ration to be provided to the migrants, first thing. And we can say that it also said that identity proof should not be insisted upon in providing such dry ration. State governments to arrange transportation for workers, this is second aspect of the directives. Then third aspect is recently Supreme Court has fixed the deadline to implement the One Nation, One Ration Card scheme by the states. Okay, this is the third directive, and under this scheme, the states are to be completing registration of migrant workers in order to provide dry ration. It also directed the state governments to run community kitchens, especially during the lockdown times. This is the fourth directive, community kitchens. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, and yes, these are the important points you should be aware about. And now Labor Ministry has been also asked to provide for registration of these migrant laborers, so that in future the government has data, appropriate data about migrant workers, and then in future, if suppose any scheme is to be implemented by central and state government, the beneficiary identification is very easy. What are some administrative problems in implementing this? Migrant workers keep on moving in search of employment, and therefore it becomes difficult to cover them all under the same scheme. Right? We can understand that there is administrative problem, and many states do not have the necessary infrastructure to run and maintain community kitchens on such large scale. Okay, so infrastructure inavailability is there regarding building such community kitchens, but that is not the excuse when the people are going, let's say, hungry. So that should not be excused by any kind of government. Fine. Yes. Any question regarding this? Okay. So you should be aware about these 3-4 points regarding welfare of migrant workers. Last year we have seen the kind of, let's say, problems faced by the migrant workers when the lockdown was announced in different parts of the country. Okay, so this is very important aspect of social justice, because these migrant workers are part of vulnerable sections of society. Now, heavy weight showdown shown the door as Prime Minister Modi rejects cabinet. So we'll not go into the details of names, who got which ministry and all. Just we have provided this information. You can read that from downloading this PDF. So you need not to remember all these things. Let me give you one point here, that new ministry is created, that is cooperation ministry. And our home minister Amit Shah is made the union minister of that ministry. Cooperation ministry, new ministry is created. Okay, so that information you can remember about. Fine. So yes, one prelims MCQ, though we can understand directly you will not be able to solve this, but we wanted to tell you what kind of question we need to prepare here. If you are aware about, you can attempt this question. Okay, so which of the following reports is or are released by World Economic Forum? Actually, there was one context that, yes, Global Gender Gap Report was released by World Economic Forum. In that article, we discussed that, right? So actually from that, we took this context of asking such kind of question. We are expecting such kind of question. Already there is match the pair type of question asked by UPSC. Now, such kind of question wherein one agency releasing many such reports can be asked here. Yes, Global Risk Report, recently it was also in news. It is also released by World Economic Forum. Also, Global Technology Governance Report, this is also released. You should be also aware about reports released by other international organizations, important like World Bank, IMF. So, this Global Financial Stability Report is released by IMF, International Monetary Fund. Okay, so fourth is incorrect here. So answer should be 1, 2, 3 only here. Okay, so in this manner you can prepare. Whenever any report is there, you can visit the website of World Economic Forum, and their reports tab is there. Many such reports are released by World Economic Forum. UPSC has already asked the question regarding reports of World Economic Forum in prelims examination. Okay, yes, some important captions and quotations I was talking here in that social issues topic regarding demographic, like India has entered a demographic sweet spot that will continue for another 2 to 3 decades. Now, half of India's population is under 29 years of age, which means that this period a greater proportion of young population will drive India's economic growth and social progress. So they must not only be given healthy, knowledgeable and skilled, but must also be provided with rights and choices to develop their fullest potential, including specially sexual and reproductive health and rights. So health, education and skill, along with that the rights and choices. Okay, so yes, woman who has control over her body gains not only in terms of autonomy but also through advances in health, education, income and safety. She is more likely to thrive and so is her family. Such kind of statement should be written whenever question is regarding women empowerment or essay topic related to women empowerment. Okay, so that's why we are providing such important captions and quotations. So you can download this PDF, you can note them down, prepare one, let's say, separate notes for essay paper captions and quotations. You can write them here from these The Hindu newspaper articles. Okay, yes, so these were important articles. Any question regarding this? Yes. Yes.
And the questions are typically asked from the duration between the brains, three and major, sir. The type of current of the question,
okay.
The alpha, between the duration of the brain, so is that true?
Not completely true. They are asked before prelims, from the before prelims examination current affairs also. Actually, when we talk about the mains examination, GS2 paper, GS3 paper, syllabus points, they are actually contemporary issues, not any current affairs issue. So when we talk about contemporary, that over the period of time, those issues are in continuation and being evolved, being dealt by the government. So you need to be aware about the developments for at least 1 year or 1.5 years regarding that issue. Okay. So that's why it is said that you should be aware about the current affairs of last 18 months before mains examination. Last 18 months before mains examination. Okay. Yes. Yes, yes. Yes. So those issues are in continuation, and after prelims examination you have only 2 months. So you will be missing on many such issues in those newspapers.
Right.
Yes, yes, yes. Okay then. Yes, we'll meet tomorrow at same time. Thank you.
Contact us to avail the combo offer of General Studies and Public Administration optional with 20% discount.